growing up as a Muslim American, I've always felt that I kind of had more of a burden to be an ambassador to my religion, especially growing up in a country that, you know, is obviously very secular, but a largely Christian. So when you grow up with that kind of responsibility to your identity, you always imagine yourself one day taking a step fulfilling that identity. And even as a little girl, I knew that I would grow up to, you know, wear the hijab. The reason why I wear it is because, you know, I'm blessed to have my mom here, and she told me when I was a little girl that whenever you see a diamond or a piece of very, you know, a rare jewel, you rarely ever see it exposed to the elements. You rarely ever see it, you know, uncovered, you know, in a place that it's not taken care of. So whenever you're modestly dressing for your religion, you know, we're the diamonds and we're the jewels. So it's, you know, it's an honor to, you know, have ourselves covered up modestly, especially to allow people to see us for, you know, to get to know our personalities, the way we think, you know, instead of just, you know, mainly by our figures. So I've always wanted to kind of challenge people to get to know me a little better as a person, not to just judge me solely from what I'm wearing or sometimes what I'm not wearing. So.
I can. I started to wear the hijab whenever I went back home to Palestine. So it's kind of like a different setting than being here in America, even though I was born and raised. Over there, it's more of a cultural thing. It's not, no one judges you by what you're wearing. Everyone is wearing it. And it was more of, it was more comforting to wear it over there. And then when I came back to the States, I did not feel that I had to take it off to please people because of what was going around and the news and what the social media portrays us as being Muslim and how they have to fear Muslims. So I'm still wearing it.
All right, so most of my family, I have a huge family, most of them wear it, like most of the adults and the parents, and I mean like the females, obviously. I come from a family of like, there's four girls and one boy, and none of us are wearing it so far. I just have felt like a lot of people think it's just like putting the scarf on and like you go out and that's it, that's all there is to it. But I feel like there's so much more to it. I feel like you need to like she said, you're representing. I feel like it'd be easier if it was in another country. Like everyone is wearing it, it's the norm. But here you're representing your religion to an entire like group of people who aren't Muslim that see this like sort of negative like perspective of Islam in the media. So I felt like I feel like I'm not ready as a person, and I'm not mature enough, and that I'm not ready to represent my religion in that way. I'm like rambling. Give me a sec. I just feel like it comes with much more than just putting it on. You have to act. There's like when your modesty is not just what you're wearing, it's like the way you act and the way you portray yourself. Yeah, and so it's a huge commitment to. I don't want to be that person to like take it off and put it back on. So I don't feel as committed as a person. I do one day. I do plan on wearing it, and I want to wear it. But I feel like I'm not. Yeah, I don't want to commit myself to that yet. So it's more of a personal decision. It's not that I don't think it's right. I totally agree with everything that a hijab says. My mom wears it, all my family wears it. I think it's so powerful and it's such a beautiful thing, but I'm not ready to make that commitment yet.
But you consider yourself devout?
Oh yeah, I definitely consider myself a devout Muslim. I pray 5 times a day, I fast, I plan on going to Hajj. I consider myself a devout Muslim, and I think just because I don't wear that doesn't make me any less of a Muslim, if that makes sense. Like I still dress modestly, I don't wear shorts, I don't go out in swimsuits, I still portray some level of modesty. There are way more similarities between Christianity than there are differences. So there's like the three, the people of the book. So Judaism, Islam, and Christianity. And Judaism came first, then Christianity, then Islam. So we believe in the Old Testament, we believe in Jesus, we believe in Moses, all of the prophets. It's just we felt like correct me if I'm wrong, like the Bible was altered in a certain way and it was messed with by people. So God sent down Prophet Muhammad, who's not our God, we don't look at him as a holy figure, he's a prophet. He came to bring the message of Islam. And so they're a way, it's so similar to Christianity.
I mean, from my perspective, the fundamental difference between Islam and Christianity is how we believe Jesus, peace be upon him, existed. I think the main difference
difference is that we don't necessarily associate him with God. Like, God is a separate, holy cult himself, but, you know, the definition of a monotheistic religion is that we, you know, nothing's associated with God. His Almighty is just him, and then Jesus is obviously, you know, one of the most important figures in our religion. It's just, you know, his relationship to God.
So your holy book includes Jesus and Moses and Mary and
all of them, all the same, the same stories, Noah's Ark, all of those are included.
You're similar in belief to, say, the Judaistic religion, where Christ is not the Messiah; he's just more of a prophet. Is that correct?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. I understood that, but I wanted to make sure. So it's just the one God, and that's it.
What was the question?
Now, y'all can speak up a little bit because it's air conditioning. All, if you're asking a question or making a comment, please speak up. We can't hear back here.
We definitely we adhere to, you know, the Ten Commandments, even though they're not necessarily called the Ten Commandments in Islam. But, you know, don't kill, so on and so forth. Don't steal. Dress modestly. So the fundamentals of all three religions are the same. It's just a matter of the specifics of worship.
What's the most common myths you see personally from people?
There are so many.
I mean, we have a top 10 list. It's not even just like I mean, where do we start?
What's number one on your top 10 list?
Yeah,
oppression
the whole,
of women.
Oh, I think, do you want to talk about the oppression of women? I feel like that's a really big
favorites?
One.
I mean, we'll take
Yeah, what's something like, feel free to ask us. Feel free to ask us anything, like you're not going to offend us. That's why we're I mean, the oppression of women, I mean, like she was talking about, women are held in Islam to, like, a pedestal. So that whole, like, a lot of people, I feel like there's a misconception between, like, religion and culture. So people look at Saudi Arabia and they consider that, like, that's all really, oh, they're wearing veils, they can't drive, that's Islam. So that's not Islam. Women have so many rights. If you look in the Quran, there are so many rights for women owning land. They can call for a divorce. There are so many different rights. And, like, we're, the reason for the hijab and the reason for all that is so women are treated, they're not treated like an object, they're treated as a human and held to a pedestal.
I think the best study that, you know, as, you know, we're, you know, in theory, we're all scholars. I think the best bit of research that we could do is to look at pre-Islamic Arabia. You know, the term called Jahiliyyah, which is like dark, the period of darkness. So look at Arabia, how it was before Islam, how women were treated then, and look at all the things that came to help women once Islam began. Like, you know, before Islam, women weren't allowed to inherit. Before Islam, women weren't necessarily, they weren't, you know, their consent to marry wasn't a priority. But when Islam came, it, you know, it was like, okay, A, you can inherit. B, you can, you know, keep your own money. C, your consent is needed. And if a marriage happened without a woman's consent, it's unlawful in Sharia versus, you know, this whole stigma of oppressing, you know, that we're oppressed. No, not at all. Actually, we became liberated when Islam came. So I think the contrast between pre-Islamic Arabia and post-Islamic Arabia is very important.
So what the media, what you're saying is, what the media is portraying is that stereotype that women, it's more of a cultural thing, not a
like
Sharia
whole,
law or what have you.
Yeah, so the covering of the face, that's not anything required in Islam. That's part of culture. That's like...
So we're being inundated with false information, in other words.
Definitely. Like the whole, like, condoning violence. Yeah.
I mean, do you want to say
I guess violence, that's a huge one, like ISIS, Al-Qaeda, that's all, like, people I feel like associate with our religion, but that's, like,
you have to understand whoever's mass-producing these stigmas. There's a political agenda, there's a cultural agenda, but when you take religion out of all of these things, it's something more simplistic, it's something more beautiful, and I think politics and culture kind of took it and ran with it, and now everyone's objectives, it seems, from, you know, I'm a poli-sci major, so I bring politics into everything, but their agendas are to just create this animosity between people, and I think that's what we need to steer away from. Like, study the religion, don't study the so-called Muslims that you hear of. Any other questions?
More like myths, or do you experience misunderstandings on the street?
You are on roll there.
I mean, people think that we're out to get, like, non-white, that they'll, like, kill all the infidels.
No!
Like, we're, like, we are accepting of all people of the religion. That's a huge, I feel, misunderstanding. We are accepting of Christians, of atheists, of everyone. And it's a religion of Islam. It's a religion of peace. It's a religion of submission. We are focused on ourselves. We're not out to convert people. We are focused on ourselves. So I feel like that's a huge misunderstanding.
Can you marry outside of your religion, or is that like, I mean, I had a friend, devout Catholic, Methodist minister for a father, and it really caused a lot of hassle between.
Can you
Pardon?
We have to marry within the religion.
You do have to marry. Okay, I mean, you know, we're given a choice, but man, there's a lot of work to it.
Because in Islamic culture, whatever children that a marriage produces, they take after the father. They take after the father's religion and the father's name. So if it's, you know, obviously the preference is to stay within your religion, that way your kids are Muslim.
But you can marry outside.
Not outside the religion, but
the man can, right?
Yeah.
The man can?
Go ahead, explain.
Okay.
No,
I've never asked a sister that, so I was wondering.
So for example, if someone was interested in me that was not Muslim, he would have to convert to Islam, but not for me, for himself. He'd have to find himself within the religion fully to be with me. So there is a way that you can convert to be with someone that is Muslim.
But converting just to marry them is totally,
it's just
like,
wrong.
Because
you're just making him be burdened with the beliefs that he's not believing. So you hardcore Christian, make him Muslim, it's not going to happen.
It's a commit.
Yes. You have to commit and be fully understanding of what Islam is, and then put that beliefs on into your marriage and into your kids that you withhold.
And I was curious with what Dr. Mike said, that if it's a man, they don't have to follow the same rule.
If you're a male, it's just because, like she said, like, the children take after their father, the religion of their father. So I think a man is allowed to marry somebody, like, that is Jewish and Christian.
Because his children are still going to be Muslim.
Yes.
The woman, her children.
Yeah.
What is the question again?
How does a person
convert?
How do you convert?
Yeah.
Yes, since I have a new brother-in-law that just converted to Islam, he was Seventh-day Adventist. He has been studying the religion for about 3 to 4 years before he even met my sister. So he was really into, he found himself in Islam. He believed in the beliefs, and you'd have to say like a phrase, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, and you're Muslim.
And that means like,
that's a declaration.
Yeah,
yes.
Like that you
okay.
believe in only one God, Allah, which it literally is the translation for God in Arabic, and then that Muhammad is his prophet. That's it. So it's like, it's really, really easy to convert. And then obviously like you don't just say that like, Muslim, like follow like the rules.
You have to follow through with
yeah,
it.
Yeah, the pillars, pray, yeah. Yeah, so you put the 5 prayers a day, so you pray like if they're at separate times of the day, so you're required to pray those and pray on time if you can. And then, I mean, the rest of that, you read the Quran as you'd like. What's that? Yeah, you have to, those 5 prayers are required, yeah.
But you know, the daily, you know, things of a Muslim, there's essentially 5 pillars of 5 pillars of Islam. So there's declaration of faith, which is your first step to actually become, you know, acknowledge yourself as a Muslim. Number two, it's the five daily prayers, what Layla talked about. Number three, it's the concept of zakat, to give charity. Number four, it's fasting the month of Ramadan. Muslims are all, you know, that's a mandatory thing across the board. And number five is to perform the pilgrimage once in your lifetime, if you're able to, from like a financial, logistical perspective. But that one is, yeah, financially and health-wise. So, you know, obviously if you're sick, physically unable, then it's okay. But that's kind of the basics of it.
What was it like watching your children in this culture? What was that like for you?
It was a challenge.
A challenge?
Yes.
Did she apparently made it?
Everything went good.
Well, it looks like you did really well.
Thank you. I hope so.
Is, let's say, Muslim the only path that you view that can get you to God?
As a devout Muslim, that's, yes, that's the preferred path. But that's not to say that God is going to not allow you to enter his heaven if you deviate from that path. Because a main concept of Islam is that only God is the judge, and only God knows if, you know, what's inside of you, regardless of, you know, what path. Because Islam came at, you know, about 1400 years ago. Obviously, there wasn't always this concept of, you know, Prophet Muhammad, read the Quran, so on and so forth. So it's not to say that all of these people before them, from Adam and Eve until here, are going to enter hell because they didn't follow the same specific way that we worship. But, you know, there's always the concept in Islam, again, that God is the one who judges. Like, it's not for us to judge.
A lot of the stereotypes, I think, that we've talked about early on in the media, is that it's portrayed that the women are not allowed in the very center part of that mosque area, that they're separated in that. Is that true, or is that...
In any mosque, or...
Okay.
No,
in any mosque, or...
Because we're old.
Or like women aren't allowed, or, you know, we have lots of things in our media, in our TV shows that we watch, that create and help fester those stereotypes. And so, you know, is there men and women actually sitting there, you know, together, or are they separated?
It's separated. They're in the same area, but they're separated. So if this was, like, if this lecture was held at a local mosque, you know, the men would be on one side, the women would be on the
okay.
other side.
And it is just on Friday, or can you go anytime?
No, you can go pray any time. So there are five prayers a day. You're welcome to go pray those.
There's always a congregational prayer held, but it's a matter of when you can.
But you're pretty much, Friday is the Advent, is Saturday, the hours.
Friday is the weekly sermon.
Okay.
And
then we
people go on holidays and stuff.
So why are you split, like half and half?
When you're praying and you're like, you come to the mosque to focus on God, right, and to worship. So I feel like there's a distraction when men and women are intermingled, that there's a distraction just to separate, like to get rid of that distraction, so where you're totally focused on God. I think that's the separation. It's not a matter of oppression. I think some mosques have it where it's like women in the back and men in the front or whatever, because like during your prayer, you're like, there's a part where you're like bent over. So like out of respect towards the women, like bending over, like that's another
like
reason
I don't
for
want
it.
To pray to my God, but feel self-conscious that some creature behind me is
like staring. Yeah, so it's a matter to get rid of that distraction. Is that right?
Yeah.
And back.
Respect. Yeah, out of respect towards the women and the men, keep separated.
So back to the mosque. Do they? How involved in the community are they?
They're pretty involved.
Yeah,
I go to. I teach at Khalid al-Mosque on the weekends, and I think once a month or maybe bi-weekly, there's always like homeless shelter feeding, or there's like clean up a specific neighborhood in DFW. So there's always like volunteer opportunities that go around. There's always a community thing that's going around. 2 weeks ago, there was interfaith, so we had people from local churches and people from local synagogues that came, and you know, we had a good, you know, monotheistic theological talk, so there's always that activity.
I take a lot of people from religious classes at TCU, like Christian, like Bible classes and stuff, to come visit the mosque, and they like sit back and watch, and they're very welcoming them. So any of you are welcome to visit a mosque to just to see what it's like. Even the lecture, you'd think it's actually in it's given in English, so they're more. I think another misconception, sorry, off topic, that all Muslims are Arabs. Like, no, we're like a tiny percentage.
There's twice as many Muslims in China as there are in Saudi Arabia. How's that for a stereotype?
Yeah. Fun fact of it.
Now, is it your mission, a Muslim's mission, to proselytize, to convert others?
Is our mission to convert others? I wouldn't really say so, no.
I mean, the concept of missionaries isn't as obvious in Islam, or at least in Islamic culture, because for us, it's kind of each person is like their own ambassador to their religion. So, you know, be a good person, be a good neighbor, be a good coworker, and that in itself is the calling to your religion. Like, you don't have to stand somewhere on a corner and hold up a poster or sign or whatever, but it's, you know, based on your actions, because you want people to see what, you know, a Muslim moderate really is. It's not, you know, just calling to, like...
So basically,
like,
converting someone in the Muslim sense is going about your business.
Yeah, I mean, show how what a Muslim is, what our religion is truly about, and maybe hopefully somebody will recognize it and see that and become interested in it. But we're not out doing missionary work or anything like that. You focus on yourself and your religion.
And I think from my perspective, everybody focused on their own journey towards, you know, whatever religion we want to, then we'd be a lot better off.
Yeah,
for sure.
It's a traditional to have a big family. One of the things that keeps the religion growing.
As a big family.
Yeah, I mean,
I have three older brothers, so
I feel like it's more of an Arab thing, honestly, like more of a cultural thing, and it's getting less and less. But I mean, back then, a lot of families, like a lot of parents had a bunch of kids. Now it's getting less.
Because most Desi families, like you know, Afghanistan and towards East, or maybe South Asian, like they have maybe 2 to 3 kids. But for Arabs, that's nothing. So
yeah, we like huge families.
Like,
so
we're always worried that the kids are gonna get bored. Like, no, we need to have more kids.
Yeah. So it's, I think that's more of a cultural thing for sure. We're not trying to like make as many Muslims,
in
the world take over. Yeah, it's not our goal. Yeah. I only have plan on having like 2 kids. So
you speak for yourself.
Are you basically saying, because my opinion, there's Christians out there that are, like, extremists, like you were talking about, and, I mean, my opinion, they're not Christians, I don't believe.
Exactly. Yeah.
Is that kind of what you're saying?
I totally don't think they're Muslim. Those people are evil. I feel like they're...
Well, there's no way KKK is Christianity. Yeah. I think I know enough about Christianity that I just don't associate the two at all.
Okay, she had a question.
Y'all have to talk about like your schools, like UTA and all that, and TCU and how you like it. And then another one was, I know that your parents were originally here first, and that you were raised here, but why did they come here?
Good question.
You can ask.
Yeah,
answer the second one first.
I mean, TCU, like, there's a small community of, I love TCU, it's, like, my best experience I've ever had in my life, honestly. I mean, to relate it back to our religion, there's only Texas Christian University, but it's pretty, like, I don't feel any sense of Christianity there, I don't have to go to Bible classes or anything, it's pretty chill. But there's probably 30, 40 Muslims there. I met a few. I'm the president of the Muslim Student Association there, so there's freedom of religion, there's... Yeah, so it's I love the school, it's awesome. But that's kind of off topic. And then my parents, my dad came here to go to school and dropped out and got a job. So just like any immigrant, come here for better opportunities. So my mom came here to visit her brother and they met here. So
at TCU, do you like the football game?
She's a big fan.
Yeah.
Her picture's on Facebook.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I love TC football. I love sports, though. So.
Can I get a question that, Aliyah, do you, Do you have any knowledge of what it's like to be a Muslim in a small Texas town? Are there any challenges apart to others?
Being in Johnson County itself, where do I start? You get discrimination from everyone around you. You're not accepted in this community because of who you are. I've had a lot of encounters with students, administration, my peers, coworkers, not here, but I do have encounters in. It's very hard. You have Godly, which is like a very hick town. They don't like Muslims. They literally want to like push you out of their town once they see you.
How do they discriminate against you? I mean, give us an example. Like you go to eat somewhere. Are you forbidden from being there? Are you looked at? How uncomfortable do they make you?
They do make me uncomfortable to where that they throw racial slurs at you, or they just say in an Indian voice, thank you for not bombing us. Thank you, come again. Yes. Because I'm Indian, apparently, yes. Don't know where they got that from, but yes. Like, I was in Cleveland. I had signed up for classes, and I went to go get my school supplies from Staples. As I was walking up there, three guys in a truck were throwing those blurs at me. Thank you, come again, and thank you for not bombing us. And all I was like, I was in shock. I was raised not to talk back and just be polite as much as you can and just smile. And others would have done differently, I know, because there was a couple behind me, so I couldn't do anything more because I have respect to my elders. And I had told the person in the cashier, and they had to walk me out because I was afraid of my safety. As well on my at Hill College in Cleveland, when I first started my semester there in 2010, my teacher kicked me out of his class.
What?
Because he wanted, no, it's not kicking me out. He was like, just go explore the campus and just meet new people. I was like, but they keep pointing and staring and they're making me uncomfortable. So I had security walk around while I was on campus, and I had the dean of students watch me on the cameras of I didn't feel like I was safe on campus to that extent that I had them do that.
Have you been attacked?
Not attacked, just...
just verbal?
Just verbal.
What is the difference between, say, Johnson County, Hicktown, and Weatherford, TCU, and Arlington?
There's more of my people there, so...
My people! But are they more accepting?
So, okay, that's a question. When was the first time y'all encountered with a Muslim that was covered in a hijab? When was the first time?
How many of you, is it your first time?
Wait,
my last semester?
The whole...
My first place.
Ever.
Like, to encounter and speak to.
Head start. Yes, that's Eric.
Okay.
Yeah.
I had my first encounter with a man congregation.
You never talked to one or anything.
The black and all I saw was her eyes the other day. It was great.
But like in Johnson County itself, have y'all ever encountered with this? See, that's why I see that Johnson County itself is not open-minded, and they're not aware of what Muslims are and what they truly are. They just see what the media portrays us as, and they just believe it. Because I had encountered a student here in Hill, in one of my first semesters. He was like, I was raised to hate Muslims. And he made my semester living hell. Let's just say that. You had an article week for developmental English. You bring an article every week. All he would do is bring terrorism acts in Afghanistan and whatever. And he was like, oh, you're from there. You should know what goes on in your country. I was like, but I'm not from there. Little did he know, later on we became friends, and he apologized for his actions. Yes, we became best friends. Mm-hmm. Happy ending. He apologized for his actions and actually admitted that his parents raised him and to make him believe that Muslims are terrorists, so to speak.
Parental influence.
Yes, it's your environment. It goes back to human ingrowth, because I'm debating this in class as the semester goes, that it's your environment, and children do what they see. So if your parents are abusive, you're going to become abusive. It's just a chain of reaction.
No, I mean,
so a lot of
just
this,
a few,
like, actually,
last questions.
The feelings, I mean, you can't blame them because they don't know any better. They haven't learned that what you're just, only thing you're seeing is what's happening in the media.
Just kind of prohibit your monthly school.
go to the airport a lot and travel.
Oh, airport's always fun. But always on the, what is it, the randomly selected?
Randomly selected, yeah, where they
really random.
Fully searched.
Yeah.
Actually, I will give it up to the U.S., so U.S. airports have, from my experience, been a lot less,
traumatic.
Than, like, European airports.
Yeah.
So, shout out.
So, I think that's a major difference because they're just more open-minded. Like, I came from Tel Aviv to Chicago to Dallas, and Tel Aviv was the one that gave me the most trouble. They almost made me miss my flight because I was an American citizen. So, it's not just in America, it's everywhere else that there is discrimination against
me. Because you were an American Muslim, was that what it was, or just because you were an American?
American. You hold a passport, it just threatens them somehow.
Yeah, there's a lot of racism in France and Italy and like all
yes.
sorts of, France is the
That's
worst.
Not just
yeah.
going on in the U.S.
Yeah, it's not just
it's
here.
It's worldwide.
Yeah. Yeah, but like somebody like asked, I mean, it's not just like that. I mean, if you've been to Arlington, like you barely see any white people. Like it's like you feel so, like, I mean, you go to school there, like how many people.
Yeah,
so.
I honestly sometimes I feel like I even need to go overseas this summer because they're just us everywhere. Like
yes.
Library, first floor, and Starbucks, you know, like.
No,
I love that you use that word. Oh, a lot of people.
I don't want to look like a Christmas tree. Like, I don't want to shake my head and have noise coming out of it. I like simplicity.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's cool because the same way if I wear a scarf. I wear a lot of something on my neck, though.
I think it's just for weddings that I just wear the bedazzled ones, so those are special occasions.
Yeah,
they're not too
that's
crazy.
Right. That's not
yeah, you're free to, as long as it's modest, you're free
you
to express yourself.
Like,
you can't think that's cool. That's not a certain beautiful thing.
Yeah.
How do you feel about tattoos and piercings?
I mean, I have ears pierced. Shit, that's a nose piercing, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, but
piercings are okay, but
yes.
Tattoos.
Tattoos are, we see it as you are born pure and without nothing, then you should leave this earth without that alternating your body.
Like permanent.
Yes.
So like this is right.
No,
I mean.
There is tattoo removal question. No,
what if you were to get a tattoo that was symbolic of
a I mean, you could put that on a wall and you
yeah, it's just like altering your body. God gave you. We feel that same way. Like a lot of people say, like plastic surgery when it's not like medically necessary. That's altering what God gave you,
yes.
and that you shouldn't do that. So it goes in all ways, like something that's permanent.
Yeah.
That's gonna.
All right, just a couple of more questions, Karen.
Oh, I was just gonna ask, what situations is it appropriate to not wear the hijab?
I believe after 9/11 had happened, the imam had went and said, if you feel you're in an uncomfortable setting, just go ahead and take it off so that nothing will happen to you. Because life-threatening situations, you should just take it off. And then if you want to put it back on, put it back on.
Well, like when
I've,
you get home.
Oh, every day?
Yeah, every day.
Oh, yeah, I tear it off when I get
yeah.
into the driveway. I've been wearing it for 12 hours, so it's like.
There's a concept of like who's able to see uncovered and who's not. If you're in front of any male that you can possibly marry, then put it on. But if you're in front of like dads, brothers, uncles, grandfathers, you know, great uncles, sons, so on and so forth, that's.
Yeah,
one
so
of your
you're
girlfriends?
Leaving it in males that you're not related to. What's that?
Like one of your friends that's a girl? Like
you can.
Oh, no,
you
girls can see, yeah.
Girls can see your hair, yeah.
Just like someone that would be marriage material.
Yeah.
But when you're at home and you don't have that on, you're talking about modesty. Like our kids play dress up with, I mean, do you ever like go to town at home?
I mean, you can do whatever you want. It's a free for all.
Okay.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Like, two of my best friends are girls, and we hang out all the time. Would it be okay for you guys to take it off if, like, say I was like one of your best friends, but there's no intention for anything like that?
I don't think so. It's like there's always the possibility that makes sense.
Yeah.
You'll
be okay.
Maybe
I'm wearing
it, Sally.
You know, we get BFF, but.
guys are still guys.
That's actually a good thing that's going on right now. I still think you should put it on. You know, I guess they hope that someday they switch back. I really don't know. But there is, you know, that debate, like, you know, homosexual, like, you know, if you're, you know, gay or lesbian, like, should you put it on in front of, like, your lesbian girlfriend because she might be attracted to you? Like, that's, I think you should.
That's, I've never thought about that, yeah.
Is that accepted in Islam?
I think it's one of, yeah, it's just like in Christianity, like in the strict version of Christianity, it's not, like, it's not accepted, it's not natural, so that's a whole other debate, but Islam, I would say.
Yeah, I don't want to get into that debate.
Yeah.
Okay. We have run out of time. If you want to know more, you can ask Ms. Chapman or me, take sociology, visit any mosque. They have Islam 101 classes for non-Muslims. They're not trying to convert, they're just trying to teach. That's it, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
By the way, there's also some snacks, foods here. And